One, two.
Thank you.
Just telling
the airport. Alexas. Yeah.
Good morning. Good morning. Can we please settle down? We are starting now. Thank you. Good morning again. San Monani. Ninjani. My name is Musa Zondi. I have been asked to pretend to be a referee, even though I'm a player. For some, this is a day, I don't know why, that they wait for. When we announce the statistics, the minister, the deputy minister, the national commissioner, and General Mbekela sitting here in the front, what we will do is that the minister will give an overview, and when he is finished with his overview, then the general will then go into the detail, and then we'll have that long session of question and answer. In fact, we'll try and make sure that this formal session is 10 minutes to account for the 2 hours for the other session. There are MECs from the provinces sitting on the right. There are generals who are in charge of the provinces as well. If there's anyone I have not recognized, Mr. McBride and all the other important people, good morning. Over to you, Minister.
What?
I refuse. I refuse. I'm told that journalists and cameramen are directing me to a clump of mics there. That I need to sit. Okay. My bosses tell me that indeed I must sit. No, apologies for that. I'm used to doing presentations standing. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would want to take an opportunity to recognize the presence of the MECs from the provinces, to recognize the presence of the chairs of parliamentary committees, as well as provincial commissioners present, the national commissioner, my deputy minister here, the chair of the board of CIRA, and all protocol observed, really, because I think there are a number of other people here. So what I will do, I want to run a presentation, and I would ask that just this space here, the camera before me, from the beautiful lady, at least there, thanks very much, because you now have taken your seat, because I want to take it over there. I will run firstly an overview of the statistics, which will focus on essentially what the statistics are about, in some respects also the question of the approach taken and what needs to happen in the future post the statistics. I will also hint briefly around some of the policy observations that we are making and deducing from the statistics that we are presenting here today. But for starters, I do want to say that the South African Police Service is responsible for the population of about 53 million people in the country, with a footprint of about 1,137 police stations across the country. In terms of our strength, we stand at about 194,852 police versus the, of course, the population as we had spoken to. And in terms of the ratio, we stand at one policeman and or woman is to 346. In terms of an international standard, the UN standard stands at 1:450. Now, the report that we are presenting here today focuses on 17 community-reported areas of crime, as well as three police-detected crimes. Just for purposes of this gathering's understanding and the and the public at large, I will want to get into the different categories of such crimes and what each category actually entails. The first category is conduct crime. In the category of conduct crime, that's where you have your murder, attempted murder, sexual offenses, assault with the intent to inflict grievous bodily harm, common assault, aggravated robbery, and common robbery. The second category of crime is what we refer to as trio crime, which essentially is robbery of motor vehicles, robbery in residential areas as well as the other premises such as the business premises. And then the third category is contact-related crimes, which essentially entails your arson and malicious damage to property. The fourth area of the fourth category is property-related crime, which basically is your residential house breakings and breakings into other premises, theft of motor vehicles, theft of out and from motor vehicles, as well as the stock theft. And then you have the other category of serious crime, which in a sense are your fraud-related crimes and shoplifting. Insofar as the police detected the serious crimes, to work, proactive work done by the police in detection of crime, and of course leading to subsequently to arrests of criminals. Now, here we're talking to unlawful possession of firearms and ammunition, the question of driving under the influence of alcohol and or drugs, the unlawful possession of and dealing in drugs. The third area that we want to talk to is about, firstly, let me just say this, the statistics that are going to be presented are based on raw figures. In other words, the cases reported and cases dealt with which would have led to arrests and or subsequent convictions. So that's the one area. The second area is that we're talking to figures that have been audited by the Auditor General of South Africa. Thirdly, is that there have been concerns expressed in the past about the integrity of our crime statistics, and we want this point noted that in relation to those particular concerns, we have already started work with Statistics South Africa with a view to look at how to actually improve integrity and quality of our statistics. And we have got to the partnership itself is yielding a situation where we address statistics emphasizing on particular key principles. One of them is relevance and accuracy, timeliness and accessibility of stats, as well as interpretability of statistics, coherence, methodological soundness, and integrity of statistics. Now, in the next few weeks, it is expected that the South African Police Service and Statistics South Africa will enter into a memorandum of understanding with a view to begin to deal with these particular principles as enunciated here in dealing with the issue of crime statistics going forward. But essentially what it means, ladies and gentlemen, is that in the future you will have a double assurance, if I may put it that way, quality assurance. Firstly, we will continue to be audited by the Auditor General of South Africa insofar as crime stats are concerned, but also secondly, it will be this work with the Statistics South Africa. Insofar as performance outlook, we stand at about 84% of community reported serious crimes, in other words, the walk-ins into our police stations and complaints that have been followed up leading to arrests and charges, which accounts for 1.7 million people that have been arrested and charged. Now, insofar as the police detected crimes, we stand at about 16%, which in itself sees an increase from the previous reporting period, which essentially has accounted for 1.3 million arrests. Now, the question though is, what is it that is suggested by the statistics as they are presented? Firstly, is that generally the trend, the 10-year and the 5-year trend shows a decrease in incidences of crime in the country. However, in the year under review, the year under review being 2013-2014, has seen an increase in some other categories of crime. One of them is murder, followed by attempted murder, robbery with aggravating circumstances, common robbery, theft out of motor vehicles. So in a sense, essentially we have about six areas of reported crimes and categories that have shown an increase in the year under review. But let me also just stress that even though we have had that these increases in the year under review, in your 2013-2014 financial years, still the trend in overall, the 10-year and 5-year trend, still is on the decrease. On the positive side is that in the year under review, we have also shown a decrease in other areas of crime, such as commercial crime has also taken quite a bit of a decrease. Stock theft has gone down. Sexual offences also do show a downward trend. However, let me also just stress that the question of sexual assault and rape in our society still is a matter that has got to be tackled by all responsible citizens in actually eradicating this scourge amongst ourselves. And the decrease does not necessarily suggest that there are no incidences of sexual violence against women and children, and as well as incidences of rape. They still do exist. However, in terms of the reported cases and cases dealt with, numbers do show an increase. Shoplifting has also gone down. Theft of motor vehicles and motorcycles has also gone down. Incidences of arson, common assault, malicious damage to property has also gone down, as well as assault with intent to inflict grievous bodily harm has also gone down. Burglary at non-residential premises, as well as burglary at residential premises, has also gone down. Now, we've made some few observations about the statistics in terms of what they actually do suggest. Firstly, is that even if you were to look at the 10-year or 5-year trends combined with the year under review, our social outlook as South Africans continues to be dominated by a permanent feature of conduct crime. So that's your category that, whether we go down or go up, still is quite prevalent in relation to the rest of the other categories of crime. And that in the past 5-year period, there has been an increase also in social unrest. Now, that in itself poses another challenge, you know, firstly, not only just from a policing point of view in terms of resources that must then be allocated to that, but it also suggests that there has got to be a broader and a macro solution found to try and stabilize that area, for an example, which leads to social unrest. Thirdly, is that we also do observe that there are still high levels of violence and aggression in our society, and that in itself is also quite a serious concern to us, and it should be a concern to all South Africans, that we do need to mediate the culture of violence amongst ourselves, as well as the aggression. The other areas that we also make quite an observation that in areas where there have been effective partnerships, be it with business and other areas of partnerships, for an example, those areas have tended to benefit insofar as decreasing the levels of crime. Now, also, we do want to think that insofar as the issue of the decrease in incidences of sexual crimes, that is also attributable to a heightened level of social consciousness amongst the citizens. And that in itself is derived from public campaigns that have been consistently waged by government on issues of the rights of women, the rights of children, and issues of gender violence in broader terms. So we think that's more to do with that work conducted at that level. The fifth point is that, of course, socioeconomic inequality continues to contribute to levels of crime in our society. The other point we would like to make is that the prevalence of drugs and alcohol abuse in our society is extremely concerning. In most of our communities these days, you tend to find more taverns than schools and churches combined. And that's quite a concerning kind of trend, because in areas, not that in areas, but also the question of drugs and alcohol abuse, they tend also to be a production point for criminal activity and so on. So these are areas that all of us as the South African citizenry would also need to concern ourselves with. And that, as the South African police will also continue to do the work that we have been doing, and will show also the statistics in terms of how we're fared insofar as the question of illicit drugs, and how we have tended to increase around the efforts that we've made in that regard, as well as foiling and closure on illegal liquor outlets, as well as the clandestine drug laboratories in the country. And that in the year under review, we have confiscated quite large quantities of drugs in the form of DAHA, Menrex, cocaine, tick, and liquor. And we'll continue to step up these particular efforts. And that moving forward, there is a need to begin a national kind of engagement or dialogue around the question of the specific features of our crime. And that such a dialogue has got to achieve a situation where we activate members of our society to be part of the fight against crime and corruption. But also, on the one hand, also is the need to regenerate our morality as society. We will definitely start working in that sort of direction ourselves as a South African Police Service to look at ways and means of how do we begin to have this discussion amongst ourselves, so members of the community in all sorts of forms and the manner in which they are structured, non-governmental organizations and other formations will also be invited to kind of engagement of that particular nature. Now, we will do so, amongst other things, precisely because we also do want to focus on four pillars of our strategic outlook. One of them is the need to continue to strengthen, to make a contribution towards strengthening the criminal justice system in the country. And that talks to the work that we need to do within the context of the criminal justice cluster as a whole in government. The second area is the area of professionalization that we need also to speak to. Now, amongst other things is the question of improving our levels of service delivery at our service centers in the form of police stations. We are putting together a project which in the next month or so will also be launching a service delivery, a frontline service delivery improvement program with a view to also look at, amongst other things, what is the ideal outlook of a police station, for an example. Yourself as an individual member of our society, if you walk into a police station, what is it that you should actually ideally experience and be subjected to? So under professionalization, we'll also be looking into that. Demilitarization is also one important element, and demilitarization in this particular instance, we are referring to an approach to policing that tends to be, you know, more often than not, when we talk demilitarization, people think of ranks, and that, you know, it means we're doing away with ranks and so on. The issue is we need to work on the state of mind insofar as issues of policing, as well as in particular a public order, an emphasis on issues of public order policing. The fourth pillar is the question of building safety using an integrated approach. And this is a pillar that wants to advocate and encourage active citizenry, for an example, around issues of policing and creation of a safe and secure environment in the country. So that all of us as South African citizens have got to make a contribution in reducing the levels of crime, but also fighting crime and corruption in our society. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. So that's just generally the overview on that. And I would ask now the National Commissioner to zoom into the statistics and the actual figures in terms of the areas that have been highlighted in the overview. Thank you very much, National Commissioner.
Honorable Minister, Honorable Deputy Minister, Maggie Sotyu, Honorable MECs present here today, chairpersons of our CPFs, leaders of the other entities that are in the police ministry, honorable guests, let me take this opportunity to thank you, Minister, to allow me on behalf of the service to then present the numbers that you have introduced in your opening remarks. As we present the figures for crime statistics in 2014, let me start off by saying indeed we continue to see some decrease in the overall rate of crime. We have noted some increase in the detection of drugs, whilst we have noted some decline of crimes against women and children. As police, we remain very focused on that matter because it is an issue that requires all of us as a nation to give attention to. We gave this report against our concern about contact crimes that remain stubborn. And as you would know, those are crimes where police come after the fact. It's an end-of-tail intervention. And as we detail the outcomes thereof, we would also be saying the maintenance of safety and security is not just a police matter, but rather a societal issue. Let me move on to talk about the reporting background. The Minister has touched on some issues, but perhaps it is important for us once more to just remind ourselves on what is the remit of us as the police. It is well articulated in section 2053 of the Constitution, where we are required to prevent crime, to combat crime, to investigate crime, to ensure that we maintain public order so that citizens can go on with their commercial, social, educational, religious lives without disturbance, to protect and to secure the inhabitants of the Republic as well as their property. And finally, it is our duty to uphold the law, so we continue to enforce the law. I think as I give this report, let me also bring to your attention the fact that One of the outcomes that we're primarily responsible for as police is outcome 3, which requires that we do our job to ensure that all people in South Africa are and feel safe. It is important for us to deal with that outcome because it's bifocal. The first outcome is that we must make, the first part of that outcome is to ensure that people are safe. As we are gathered here today, we are looking at that R side of things, because it talks to the reduced levels of serious crimes and how do we measure that. We come to you to talk about the statistics to say, are we able to show that there is a reduction or an increase of levels of crime? So that's the one part. The second part of that outcome talks to the feel. Do citizens in this country feel that they are safe? And I want to say it's an area that is work in progress, and we're doing a lot to also develop tools and systems and measurement criteria. A point in case is that together with the monitoring and evaluation department, we're working on a citizen-based monitoring mechanism to measure the satisfaction levels of communities. The pilot is quite advanced, and we are hoping that in future we would also be able to face the public and also give a report. Secondly, as police in this area, we are conducting objective safety audits and customer satisfaction surveys. It is sitting in our medium-term strategic framework as an in this fifth administration. That will be something that we will be advancing, and we shall be reporting to the public. Thirdly, you would also know that Stats SA conduct victims of crime survey. And those surveys tell us how many people feel free to walk at night alone, or children feel free to play in the street. So we're developing a number of tools and streams to measure the field side of things. So today, as we are gathered here, we are giving you the R side of things, which talks to the statistics. I also, again, would want to say, why are we reporting in this fashion? In 2005, Cabinet took a decision on the release of national crime statistics that it shall be done on an annual basis. Finally, supporting what the Minister has already indicated about our work with Stats SA, we also established a task team to develop a crime statistics policy that is almost finalized. And in that, we've done a number of things. Issues such as counting rules and refining some of the crime definitions. So that is the background that I thought I would share before we start. As I continue with my presentation, let me indicate that the Minister has we will focus on actual crime figures as they are reported. You would know that in reporting crimes, you are having, if we had 20 murders this year, and next year we have 26 murders, the difference would be those are real reported crime figures. We also query our matter differently by bringing in ratios. In terms of ratios, it's for comparative purposes, so that you are able to compare country to country, province to province, area to area. In that regard, we take the same crime reported figures and compute them per 100,000 citizens of a country. What you will have on your memory stick as you live here, you will have the raw figures, that which was used to call, is called the raw figures, the actual reported crimes, as well as the computed ratios. They will also be there on our website for you to be able to compare the report that we have given you. Let me also talk to you about the issue of how we are reporting this crime. The Minister has touched on that, but for purposes of walking with me through this presentation, I shall again just touch on that. We are adopting a longitudinal approach because, as you would know, crime is a social phenomenon. And it is therefore important for us to show longitudinally how it is performing. We also, however, even if we say that, recognize the fact that it also impacts on, you know, the economy of the country and all those type of issues. And it is for that reason that I would like you to work with me when we deal with this presentation, because we look at the 10-year range. We then look at how this particular area had performed in 5 years, and then we look into the in-year. So when you see the graphs, you'll see three areas that tells you about the 10 years, 5 years, as well as the in-year that we're looking into. If you look at the presentation that I'm giving you, we are talking about five crime categories. The contact crimes, which have a number of subcategories in them, and those categories, subcategories would include the contact crimes, would be murder, attempted murder, sexual offences, assault GBH, common assault, robbery aggravating, and common robbery. So when I talk about, when I introduce contact crime, I will then go into those subcategories to indicate to all of you how each of those subcategories have performed. The same will go with the other areas, the contact-related crimes, the property-related crimes, the other serious crimes. So we will go into all those subcategories to show how they have performed. So we are tracking 20 serious crimes in total. As you would note, on slide 4, the 20 crimes are categorized in this fashion. There are 17 what we call community-reported crimes. These are crimes where members of the community walk into the station to report a particular crime. The balance of the 20, which is 3, those are crimes that are detected by the police. They go and hold a roadblock, or they go and search a particular, cordon and search, and out of that, they identify particular crimes. So the journey I shall be walking you through would be dealing with all those 20 serious crimes in accordance with those that are reported by the community, as well as those that are tracked by the police. The minister has already alluded to the fact that the community reported crimes, people walking into the station, account for this year, as we report, 84.1% of the volume of crimes that were dealing with, and the ones that are detected by the police account for 15.9%. The minister has also alluded to a few key points there. On to that one, in terms of you know, the population figure that we are using, that is determined by Stats SA. To be precise, the population figure that we use is 52,981,991. So when you compute and look at our figures and interpret them, we would be using that population figure. And the minister has alluded to our personnel strength outside the vacancies and the ratio that we're having, the cars that we're using. And in terms of the police stations, I just want to add to that that we also have 186 satellites. We have 5 rapid rail police units, 52 contact points, as well as 14 mobiles. We will be growing our mobiles as we continue to want to increase access to the rural communities. Let me talk a little bit about this domino effect, the need for peaceful surroundings to avoid escalation of crimes. Contact crimes, that I've said, is a concern for us. If you look at that domino effect, it is important to realize that society plays a very critical role, because the police come right at the tip of that diagram that you are seeing there. Police come when a murder has happened. Right at the beginning, there would be a common assault that is ignored, that is not reported. And a common assault of yesterday becomes an assault GBH of tomorrow. And these are the type of crimes that happened in confined spaces, people who know each other, people who normally, you know, are together, people who are in houses. An assault GBH of yesterday turns into an attempted murder, because that person is now beaten to a pulp, half dead in hospital. Tomorrow, that turns into murder. It shows that if as a society we do certain things, we could actually also contribute towards the reduction of the escalation of the crimes that we are seeing. Let me then turn to our overall performance of serious crime over the 10-year period. I'll just do two or three slides to deal with the overall performance of the 17 serious crimes over the past 10 years. If you look at the slide that you have up there in terms of contact crimes, and you read it, the rates shows you that over that period, there has been some increase in a particular area. And if you look at that, overall, as the minister has said, over this period, one is able to see that, in general, there is a reduction, a continued reduction of crimes in the country. But let's go to each of those categories. If you take contact crimes in this current year, it is showing an increase of 0.5%. And I'll come and show as I go into details to say that. And we are concerned about that. It is one of the difficult and stubborn areas. And as I've said, it is the type of crimes that take place behind closed doors. It is the type of crimes that police come when they have already occurred. It is taking place roughly and mostly between people who know each other. What are we going to do? We as police shall continue to ensure that we increase our visibility, particularly in social spaces where you would see much later when I show you a concentration of shebeens, for instance, in Mangaung, one of the cities, to say we need to increase our visibility around those to ensure that as those people, you know, find themselves working at night in difficult circumstances, how could we be of help? We also want to increase cooperation and collaboration with the community so that we can increase our social discourse to talk about these issues and to ensure that, you know, once you keep your home safe, your street safe, your environment safe, the schools where your children go safe, your social space safe, we can work together and we believe we can do more. We also, as police, will continue with our work to reduce illegal firearms that are out there, because they then contribute towards this space of crimes in the contact space. You would note in the contact-related space, we've had a very, very pleasing continuous decline without interference there. Property-related crimes, last year we had an increase. Fortunately, this year we're back into the decrease. We're happy about that. And other serious crimes. So overall, longitudinally, we can, as a nation, say we continue to see some decrease on overall crime. The next slide shows that graphically to show you how this overall crime has declined. As you would see in the first 5 years of the 10 years, we had a steeper decrease of 15.5. The next 5 years had a much more a reduction of about 4.3% as opposed to the steeper one at the beginning. In the in-year, the overall decrease in the 17 serious crime is 0.4%. The next slide that you will see there then takes us to the overall performance of all these 17 crimes. You would note that of the 17, as the minister has said, there are 6 that are showing an increase. And there are 11 that are showing an increase. What I would like you to also take note of is the legend that we've put there. Where you are having a solid red without a yellow star, it shows that that type of crime has been on the increase for some time. It is not starting this current year. Where you see something else with a yellow star, it shows you that that's a newcomer, either at the decrease or at the increase. Let me start off by saying what you would see there is that of those 17 serious crimes that we are tracking, firstly, murder has increased by 5%. The next one is your sexual offenses, which has decreased by 5.6%. And it is coming down. It's a newcomer in terms of being decreased. That's why you see it having a yellow star. Attempted murder is still on the increase, but has decreased slightly, even on the increase side, but it is still a concerning area. Assault with intention to inflict grievous bodily harm has decreased by 1.5%. Common assault has also decreased by 3.3%. The one area that has actually shown some significant growth from 4.6% last year to 12.7% this year is that robbery with aggravating circumstances. Common robbery has gone up by 0.6%. Arson has gone down, we are happy. Malicious damage to property has for the first time reared its head as a decrease. Burglary at non-residential areas has also shown some decrease, as you can see, 0.04%. Burglary at residential premises, it has also shown some decrease, 0.6%. Theft of motor vehicles and motorcycles has also shown some decrease of 2.6%. And theft from motor vehicle has gone up. Stock theft has gone down by 6.2%. All theft not mentioned elsewhere has gone up by 1.6%. Commercial crimes have done very well. They've gone down by 13.6%. And shoplifting has gone down. So overall, out of the 17 serious crimes, 6 are showing an increase and 11 have shown a decrease. The map that you see there then goes into the 17 serious crime for the reported period, showing that by province. As you would note, there are 4 provinces that have contributed more significantly towards the increases that we've seen. We see Limpopo, we see Gauteng, we see Northern Cape, we see Western Cape. Now, let us then journey through the various subcategories. I shall start with the contact crimes. Contact crimes overall, as we've indicated, there has been an overall increase of 0.5% in the current year. In terms of how the province is fared, we note that Gauteng, Northern Cape, Western Cape, and Eastern Cape were not experiencing decreases. The other provinces, five of them, have had decreases. Now I go to the subcategories. Murder, as a subcategory of contact crimes, did show an increase. And we're very concerned about that, because if you look at that, we're talking at, there's about 800 more compared to the previous year. So we are concerned about murder, and we are saying murder requires also that society works very closely with us to assist us to achieve this reduction. So the next one, if we look at the provinces that have experienced a reduction, it's KZN, Free State, Mpumalanga, and Northwest. The others did not have a reduction in this space. They contributed towards the increase that we had seen in this area. The other area, subcategory of contact crimes, is attempted murder. Equally in that space, you would note that it had, last year we had an average reduction of, on the past 3 years, we had an average reduction of 0.3. In this current year, we have a 4.6 increase. In the previous year, if we look at that one, the attempted murder, it was a little bit higher than that, so we've had a slight decrease, but it's still on the negative. The provinces, as you would see on that map, Limpopo, Gauteng, Northern Cape, Western Cape, Eastern Cape, almost all of them, it is Free State that seem to have notched a decrease in terms of attempted murder. The other category under contact crimes is assault with intent to grievous bodily harm. In this current year, we have seen a decrease of 1.5%. The map that follows shows you how the provinces have fared, and I'm sure when you have time, you'll be able to analyze that further. Then we have common assault as part of contact crime also. We are happy that in that space, even though it's contact crime, one of the stubborn areas, we also notched a 3.3% decrease. The next map that follows just shows the provinces that they have come in. Western Cape did not manage to get a decrease. Most of the provinces had managed to achieve some decrease. On the issue of sexual crimes, we saw a decline of 5.6%, which again talks to the fact that in this area of sexual offences and sexual crimes, we have seen some good performance from the organisation. In terms of provinces, again, we've seen good performance by all the other provinces, except for Eastern Cape, that seems to continue to have challenges. And when we looked at that, you know, Eastern Cape is experiencing some challenges in terms of sexual offences against old people, and all those, we are looking at interventions in those areas. Rape has come down by 6.3%. We are not going to rest. We shall continue putting a lot of effort in that area. And we believe that a lot of the work that has been done for awareness in the media, some of the policies that the government has adopted, dedication of some of the departments have assisted us in really assisting to ensure that those type of crimes continue to come down. In terms of the provinces, again, I think the Eastern Cape did not fare so well. In terms of that area, the other provinces had notched some decreases. Sexual assault, again, in that area, we have realized a 4.9% decrease. And in terms of the provinces, Mpumalanga, Northern Cape, Western Cape were the ones that did not realize a decrease in the area. Robbery with aggravating circumstances. I've already indicated that it's an area that seemed to have reared its head. We had a 12.7% increase in that area. And it is an area where we will keenly focus upon. And I'm sure with these aggravating circumstances, you can also be sure that it does touch on, could be contributing to some of the murders that we see going up. In terms of provinces, again, you would note that most of the provinces did not quite achieve, but for Free State, that has managed to bring this matter down. Bank robberies. Significant declines. In the previous year, we've moved from 7 bank robberies to 21 bank robberies, with Gauteng contributing most of those. And in this area, really, one would raise a concern around issues related to as trends in terms of collusion between workers, between the security companies that are involved, as well as some of our police in this area. But we're truly grateful for the partnerships that we're having with organizations such as SABRIC, the BAC, the Consumer Goods Council, because through those partnerships, we are able to put our heads together to come up with solutions that assist us really to deal with some of these issues. As we report, I'm happy that when I looked at yesterday, the arrest that we made in Klerksdorp, the bank robbery that we foiled, you can see that our intelligence-led policing is starting to be very helpful, and some of this partnership are assisting. You'd see there, most of you would be writing a headline to say 200% increase in bank robberies. If you look at the provinces, Gauteng had one the previous year, the other year. In this period of reporting, they had 11, and it would be noted as 1,000% increase. But I think it's important to just recognize that it's a low base matter, and this is why we find ourselves where we are. In Eastern Cape, they moved from 1 to 5, but we really believe that through these partnerships that I've mentioned and the work that we're doing and our intelligence work, we can again continue to tame that type of robbery. Robbery of cash in transit, 2013-14, we can say we've stabilized. We didn't see an increase in that space. We then continue to depict contribution by the various provinces, which you can interrogate when you look at the information that we've given you. Common robbery had an increase of 0.6%, and that is how it pans out in terms of the provinces. And That then takes us out of all the first category of contact crimes. I again want to underscore the fact that it's an area that we will remain very focused upon as the police to ensure that some of those dynamic increases that we've seen shall continue to be tamed. Now, in terms of contact-related crimes, the first subcategory that we are dealing with overall, I must say there continues to be a decline in that space. We can see that overall we have a 1.3 decrease in terms of contact-related crimes. The contribution by the provinces, all of them contributed mostly positively except for Western Cape and Eastern Cape. Arson is on the decrease by 4.2% in this current financial year. That is how it plays itself out in the provinces. Eastern Cape did not realize a decrease. Malicious damage to property, we had a decrease of 1.1%. So in terms of contact-related crimes, we have seen some good decrease and good performance in this financial year. Property-related crime, which is another sub-category. Let us then look at that general performance. We've had an overall decrease of 0.2% in this current financial year. If we look at the provinces, you will see how they have contributed. There, one would say we had a Western Cape, Northern Cape, Gauteng, and Limpopo not being able to realize a decrease. The subcategories sitting there, housebreaking, we've had a decrease of 0.04%. The provinces, you can see how they've performed there. Limpopo remains a worry, Gauteng, Northern Cape, Western Cape, and Eastern Cape. Housebreaking, we've again experienced, again registering a decrease of 0.6%. That is as a subcategory of property-related crimes. It pans out as you would see, like that on the provinces. And Western Cape, noted for further focus and ensuring that they can also register some decreases. Theft out of motor vehicle, another decrease. So this property-related crimes have done fairly well overall. In terms of property-related crimes, the provinces that to be focused upon, Limpopo, Northern Cape, Free State, as well as Western Cape. Theft out of motor vehicle seems to remain stubborn. It has gone down a little bit, but it remains stubborn. Because if you look at where it was the previous year, it was at 7.0, the increase, but now it's at slightly decreased to about 3%. And I think this is because of people are more aware. They are now knowing that those gadgets, they can check their doors. There's a lot of communication around those type of issues. We hope that we will continue to see that decrease until we can get it to the green side. Stock theft has done well. We've had a decrease of 6.2% in this current financial year. And then you will note that the provinces that may still need to do a little bit more. Gauteng, for some reason, it looks like they have a lot of stock. They have 12.9% there that they did not decrease, as well as Limpopo had a challenge in this space. So overall, the property-related crime seemed to have experienced positive declines in terms of performance of the subcategories in the current year. The property The other serious crimes, which is the last subcategory, we note that overall there is a decrease of 1.4%, and the contributing provinces, Limpopo, Northern Cape, Western Cape, continue to have some challenges in that space. And in terms of the subcategories in this space, all theft not mentioned had an increase of 1.6%. And we can see the provinces there, Limpopo, Northwest, Northern Cape, Eastern Cape, Western Cape. All those six provinces did not have a decrease. Three provinces managed to have some decrease in that area. Commercial crimes, indeed, we are happy to report that 13.6% decrease in that space for the current financial year. And the provinces all contributed except for Northern Cape. Shoplifting, we have experienced again a decrease in that area of 1.1%. And overall, I can say that category of other serious crimes has also performed well in terms of contributing towards crime decreases in the area. The provinces, they're there. So that then concludes the 17 serious crimes, those that are community reported. And as I've said, indeed, the one area that remains a primary focus for us as we go forward are the contact crimes. And we really believe that through the outreach initiatives that we're having, through some of the initiatives that I've already mentioned earlier on, we will remain very focused on that area to ensure that we also realize, you know, significant decreases in that area. I now move on to the crime detected as a result of police actions in this area. You must have increases and not decreases. So it's a different on the other one, we were looking for decreases. In these three, we're looking for increases. The first one, we note that we see an increase of 18.2% in terms of the work that we're doing to detect crimes. We look at the provinces, all of them seem to have had a positive contribution towards the overall trend line in that area. When we go into the subcategories, illegal possession of firearms continues to be on the rise. We've seen an increase of 3.7% recorded for the illegal firearms that we identify. I think we collected almost something like 10,000 plus in the previous year. This is how the provinces contributed towards to the illegal firearms collection. If I can just note there, Limpopo did not reach the target, as well as Gauteng and Western Cape. We will continue to help them to ensure that we collect as much as we can. Drug-related crimes were on the increase this year by 26.1%. As you would have said, as you would have heard me when I opened my opening statement, I indicated that we continue to see an increase in the detection of drugs. We have, for instance, dismantled something like 35 drug factories in the previous year. So that is also continuing to be on the increase. The concerning issue is that it appears when this is on the increase, it may be telling us that we need to deal with the consumers much, much more so that we can create more awareness and reduce also on the side of those that want to continue to consume the drugs because it encourages the supply. So if we look at the provinces there has been a positive contribution by all the provinces. On driving under the influence of alcohol and drugs, we have seen a decrease there in terms of the detection and arrests of those that are driving under the influence of drugs. Can be one of two things. Maybe there's more awareness and people are just afraid to drive under the influence of drugs, but we will also be analyzing that together with sister departments such as transport and metro police to look at how we deal with those type of outcomes. The provinces have contributed as they are there. You can see that a number of them did not achieve the target: Limpopo, Mpumalanga, KZN, Northern Cape, Western Cape, Eastern Cape. They are having fewer people drinking. Maybe that's why we didn't find them. I then move on to the next category that deals with our management of public order policing. For the current year, you would note that we have policed 11,601 peaceful protests. We have had 1,907 unrest-laden community protests. But what is clearly observable, as the minister has said, is that there seem to be an increase in this protests, be they peaceful and be they whatever, because if you look at the peaceful ones in that other year, they were 10,517. In this year under review, there are 11,601. The unrest ones were 1,882. In this current year, there are 1,907. But we continue in terms of our community outreach to engage and to capacitate our public order policing so that people can exercise their constitutional right, but do it in a peaceful and non-violent manner. This is how the provinces contributed. You can see that Gauteng had the most, followed by Eastern Cape, then came Western Cape and Mpumalanga in terms of contribution to those public order unrest. KZN has also been mentioned. Trio crimes, those are the crimes that are already reported upon, but they are packaged differently because Cabinet was very keen to just know how these ones are doing. So I'm sure you'll be able to note it there. In terms of trio crimes, they remain very stubborn. We've already reported on them. You would note that overall, they continue to increase. They increased overall by 10.8% during this current year. And the provinces that are contributing, you can see that only Mpumalanga and Free State managed to have a decrease. All the other provinces had an increase in that regard. The subcategories of those trio crimes: carjacking, we had a 12.3% increase there. The next one is truck hijacking. There was a 5.1% increase there. The other one is robbery at other premises. There was a 13.7% increase there. Robbery residential, there was an increase of 7.4%. So the trio crimes, if you leave them out, again, you see the very same picture that we had communicated before. So that, ladies and gentlemen, brings us to the end of our numbers as we presented them. Thank you very much.
The most interesting part comes now. May I please humbly ask you to, when we get to the actual questions, to identify yourself, ask a question. There are too many people here. Well, not too many. There are a lot of people. But ask your question so that we give somebody else a chance. There is no point in asking the same question that somebody else has asked. I know sometimes it's quite tempting because it's already in your mind. The minister has just stepped out for a few minutes, so I'm not sure if you ask the if your hand is up. I hope that's a question for the National Commissioner. I will start down this row. 1, 2, 3, 4. Smilane and whoever is sitting next to you. I'll take those four as a first batch, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner. Amanda Watson from the Citizen. 1,907 unrest protests. How many of these were directed at the police and how many were directed at government?
A question that I didn't point out too. Can you repeat your question, please?
Thank you. Of the protests that happened in South Africa this year, this last year, of all the protests, how many were directed at the police? How many of the protests were directed at police?
Philip De Wet from the Mail and Guardian. Commissioner, you seem to be convinced that the decrease in total sexual offences is due to the work of the government and the police, despite the fact that we know this is a category of crime highly dependent on reporting and that reporting is highly dependent on faith in the police and the attitudes of members in front of the office. Do you have additional data or information which makes you convinced that this is due to good work? And if so, can you share that with us?
Commissioner Karen Morn from ENCA. You know, 800 more murders in 1 year is quite a disturbing number. It means 47 people are murdered every single day in South Africa. From the police's side, do you have any idea what might be leading to this increase? And then second of all, while, you know, you've argued very strongly that a lot of these social crimes can't really be prevented by police, are the police going to make more of a commitment to examining conviction rates in South Africa and looking at the detection and the way these cases are prosecuted to really evaluate whether police work in detecting those responsible for particularly murders is as effective as we would hope it would be? Thanks.
Hi, Diane Hawker from ENCA.com. Just to follow up on the issue of the sexual offences, a lot of other crimes are categorised as sexual offences, and there isn't quite a lot of detail on what is prostitution or pornography related arrests. Is there any explanation of why the police don't give sort of more of a breakdown on that, so it can be more clear, you know, where the actual sort of increases and decreases are within the subcategories in sexual offences?
Annelies Kempen from Savoma Safety and Security magazine. My question relates to something that's not specifically mentioned, but which affects all of us every day in one way or another, namely copper cable theft. We all know there's a huge increase, or it seems, in terms of media reports, in terms of increase in copper cable theft. I just want to find out, in terms of the Secondhand Goods Act, is the minister maybe considering delegating some of the powers to, say, maybe the Metro Police or some of the other role players that can also help with inspections at scrap dealers and so on? Or what is the police specifically looking at in dealing with this specific crime? Thank you.
Let's take those first four. Thank you.
All right. The first question was around protests and protests directed at police. Maybe the question is a little bit confusing, because we go out to monitor protest, community protests. We do not record protests that I haven't seen a protest that was directed at us. We go out there because there's a protest against something else. And that is why we call them community protests, because they could be service, they could be just a march of people wanting to emphasize a particular point. In this protest that we have reported, we do not have anyone that has been directed at police. The second question that was raised was, are we sure, you know, we report and faith in the police in terms of sexual offences and reporting of cases, non-reporting of cases? Maybe let me say, when I mentioned that one, I need to also maybe refer to the fact that you would recall that we have established special units to deal with issues that related to the question that you are asking, sexual offences, and they've really, really, really done well. They are in all the clusters. We've done other things also. More and more people are coming to the station because we're also, you know, having victim-friendly facilities where they can be attended to with care, with more respect. And our focus really is to encourage more reporting, the awareness programs that are taking place, the work that you are doing as the media to talk about these issues, assist towards ensuring that we can collectively achieve more reporting on issues such as this one. I wouldn't just want to say it's credit that is taken by one sector. It's a multi-input, multidisciplinary credit that we should take as a nation, each and every one, the little bit that you do to talk about the rights of people, the platforms that they are there, people to reach out, to feel free to report. We are also doing our bit as police to support all these other efforts. And I think it's not confidence just going to a government, confidence going to a government department, confidence going to a particular NGO. It's a collective effort. There is more societal conscientization around issues of sexual offences. And I think for that, as a nation, through all those multidisciplinary inputs, we can thank ourselves. And I think we should continue. We can achieve even more. The issue of the conviction rate, I just want to say, look, indeed, I think we are starting to see good convictions. If I may just say, this year, for instance, we secured 1,110 life sentences. And out of those, if I look at and it was from 803 suspects. And if I look at those, 653 of those were for crimes against women. So more and more we are seeing that happening. Have we reached a perfect state? Not at all. And I think this is why we are working very closely as clusters, such as the JCPS cluster, to ensure that, you know, as we apprehend and arrest, we can ensure that that value chain work together to achieve these convictions that we need to achieve. More work can still be done in that space, but one is starting to see light at the end of the tunnel. I think there's some good progress coming out of this whole issue of arresting convictions and all that. But we can do more, because communities continue to say, you've arrested, we see the people now in the street. What has happened to the people? So that feel aspect becomes very important as we go forward. The detailing of sexual offenses and subcategories, you know, and the sub-definition thereof, as you would have heard, the approach in terms of our reporting, we focus on the 20 serious offenses and some of the main categories. We can look at that as we go forward, and I'm sure if you engage with us, we could be able to share some of those subcategories. Unfortunately, it wasn't for me, sub-subcategories. Unfortunately, it wasn't for me part of our report here. On the issue of copper cables, and I'm sure the Deputy Minister will also talk a little bit about that because she's sitting on some committee there. The Secondhand Goods Act is very instrumental in assisting us in this space. But we're also working very closely with those that are losing these cables. We're working very closely with the cities. You know, I can tell you, for example, that people like Eskom, they were saying they are able to identify their own copper cable because they have marked it in a particular fashion. And the criminals are ahead of us, because what they do, they burn it, and it loses its identity and mark. So what we need to look into is how best we can further enhance this act to ensure that those that sell second-hand goods such as copper cables could be able to declare and show us the source. Where did they buy it? When it goes to any ship, where does it come from? So we need to look at some of those issues. It's an area that we're working very closely on. DM, I don't know if you would want to comment also on the
question with regard to the copper cable theft, but I will say what I know, because I was out when the question was asked. But as General correctly indicated, that immediately after the election, there is an interministerial committee that has been established by the President, of which us as the police, we are the leader of that committee, together with other sister departments like your municipalities, that is the local government, or COCTA, and all this. And then where then we sit with our hawks, as you know, are there are the guys that investigate this kind of crimes. And the committee has brought along all the stakeholders, general, from all 9 provinces, and some of our investigators from another element. But as for now, there is nothing that we can say that what the committee is going to do. But it is an international crime, the copper cable theft. It's not a small thing. It's a big thing. Thanks.
I must also indicate that in our engagement with business representatives, it is also a point that we pointed out that we do need to have quite some serious engagement on the issue of the scrap metal industry in particular, because that's where also your copper cable theft also falls under. We have had incidences that are quite upset, for instance, in the country where a section of a railway track completely stolen and then sold. Now, and we're saying, look, we need to find firstly, we need to find each other in terms of addressing this particular matter, but at the same time, look at ways and means in which we would have to play our respective roles to deal with this matter. But as the Deputy Minister says, it's quite a big issue in the sense that it also has an international dimension into it. But we'll have to do our level best to look at how it has got to be addressed within our own context. Thanks.
I will take questions from the other side. Kolani, your side, do they have questions? Oh, no. Okay. Barry?
Pretorius from ENCA. It sort of links to Barry's question about the trio crimes, but more specifically, it's policeable crimes. Theft out of motor vehicles, robberies, hijackings, it's policeable issues specifically with regards to intelligence. By the police's own account, intelligence has gone down by 30 to 60%. So what are the police actually going to do about this and the issue? And how big is that visible policing issue together with crime intelligence to actually these policeable type of things to get it down?
Commissioner Sonia Carstens of the Bild newspaper. Banks are being targeted, especially in Gauteng. Why, what's the reason for this, and what role does syndicates play in this? Thank you.
Commissioner.
Amagelang Mbata from Bloomberg News. Commissioner, you said murder rose 5%. Is that the murder rate or the number of murders? And if you could please clarify in terms of the total number of murders for the financial year that you reported on, as well as the murder rate compared to last year. Thanks.
Can we please take this special question?
The murder rate for last year. Remember, I said our focus is on actual reported crimes. In the previous reporting period, we had 16,259 murders. The current one is 17,068. So those are the, whatever you can do a straight line subtraction, you will see that it's about 800, 800 and I think I'm a smallish digit there. So if you can do that straight line subtraction. So it's like the previous year was 16,259, and as we report now, we are reporting that they have increased to 17,068. That's the one on murder. Okay, the next question was about the banks in Gauteng, the role of syndicates. Indeed, bank crimes are by and large highly organized, and you cannot rule out the issue of syndicates in this regard. And part of what, you know, like the bus that we had yesterday in Klekso, you need intelligence-led policing to assist you in this regard. And this is why we're starting to see a number, we've had a number of busts in this regard, and we are focusing a lot on our intelligence to ensure that we fight this syndicate. So it's a matter that we're looking into, and we are ensuring that this current surge can be dealt with much more closely and much more critically. I don't know, Minister, if you want to comment on this one before we move on to the other one.
Is that the intelligence?
Yeah, it's...
It's just that I did not properly understand the question, but the question seems to be suggesting that we must have said ourselves as a South African Police Service that our intelligence has gone down. Now, I do not know which particular part of the presentation wants to suggest that, except to say that the figures that we have presented here today do suggest that we have more increased, we have an increased level of intelligence work that informs our policing. So one example for an example is the reduction insofar as the issue of commercial crime, which is part of your organized crime. And you can't dent that area of crime unless you have strong intelligence sort of activities that have got to drive towards that direction. During the presentation, the National Commissioner made a reference to foiling a bank robbery, for an example, in, did you say Klerksdorp? I think Klerksdorp, yes. Now, again, that's part of the intelligence, you know, a driven kind of activity. The drug laboratories that have been, that we have had to close down, again, that's intelligence work and so forth. So that's why I'm saying I maybe didn't understand the question, but perhaps contrary to whatever the understanding could be, the issue is that more intelligence activity informing our work as the police. So yeah, let me just leave it at that. Thanks.
Let me just add to that one to say, one of the things that we've done, you know, we've, each of the provinces have their top 30 wanted criminals and their top 15 syndicates. And together with these partners that we're having, the sub-rigs and all those, we compare notes. We're able to see that one who's a top, the top syndicate in Eastern Cape is probably also operating in Northern Cape, and that type of work is starting to assist us quite a lot, because we realize that we're almost chasing common people. And we've started seeing it also when we were intervening in this mall robberies that we started seeing. Once we started identifying and looking at the CCTVs and all those things, we were able to see that it's a common trend, it's a common team of people. So we have that, you know, what I would call top 300 criminals that we're looking for, and we look at where else are they operating. And if you check, and you check the database of Sabrik, you check the database of Limpopo and Eastern Cape, you find certain common people. So that we have done as a police, and it's really starting to assist us quite a lot, talking to the organized side of crimes and syndicates and all those. The issue of theft out of motor vehicle that you raised as part of the issue, it has started going down. But remember that also, these thefts are taking place also in the malls, where we are having security. Remember, as police, we don't actually do inner perimeter policing. So that is where we need to work very closely with mall owners. I know that General Mutiba, just in last week or so, had a big meeting with those mall owners. We are planning a further one with the Consumer Goods Council because we want to look at how we can connect our efforts to ensure that we have a broader cover of this type of issues. And we're glad that we're seeing, even though it's still looking red, there is a slight decrease in terms of that one, which means citizens are also more aware of responding to some of these gadgets that are all over the place where you think you've locked your car and people can get it opened. And it's another form of desperation because if they can't steal your car, then they must at least wait for you to go out and then break your car and take things out of your car. Because now the nature of alarms that we're putting in, that's why we're starting to see a decrease in terms of cars being stolen and now people targeting what is inside the car when a person is not there. So those type of processes are also requiring that be vigilant as a car owner, also care where you put your car. Let's work closely with those that are running the businesses of parking these cars in the malls and elsewhere so that we can reduce this type of crime. The police will also increase their visibility. We will work with the municipalities. You know, we have a cooperation and collaboration with the police chiefs in the metros so that we can again also look at working together and ensure that we deal with other things. And you then raise an issue around residential robbery. Indeed, it is an area for concern. In terms of residential robbery, again, I shall say, it requires all of us. You need a safe home, a safe street. You must ensure that your house is also secured because police cannot be in each and every house. Police can be in the street to ensure that there's visibility, but we would rely quite a lot on the house owner to ensure that every, you know, I always say the house is the first police station you get in any society. You want to worry that your gates are locked. You want to worry that your children are sleeping safely. You want to worry that your cars are locked, your garages are locked. You want to worry when you finish, you know, looking at the safety of your house that you have a safe street where your children can play in the street without being whatever. So you want to know your neighbors, you want to know what's happening. So there is quite a lot that we need to do together, particularly around issues of residential robbery, knowing whatever, and the work that is being done by communities to have a community watch and all those things, street watches, that is very helpful because, yeah, and patrols. It helps a lot because then we can work together as a nation to combat some of these crimes. We can reduce some of these crimes, but we can never say we can get rid of them at 0 point. But it is when we work together to ensure that we don't get this, you know, having a free for all with this type of crimes and all of us being uncomfortable. So the police, together with the community and all these initiatives, are very helpful to actually deal with this type of issue. Collaboration is the rule of the day and ensuring that we can connect our energies to cover the ground. Okay. And you know, some of the initiatives, we're just launching a conference that is going to take place, the Crime Line one, the Crime Stoppers, whistleblowing as communities to say what is happening around you. We know the people that are not supposed to be there. Tell us that they are strangers that are here that we don't understand so that we can work together and come and arrest them. So it's cooperation all the way and collaboration.
The minister thinks we are all exhausted now. I don't see hands. Ah, there is a hand. Shall we make this the last round? That side as well. Huh? Okay, we'll come to you. We'll start down this row, and to the back and to that side as well. Thank you.
Annelies Kempen from Savomus Magazine again. I know that my question relates to vehicle hijacking and track hijacking. I know that there's excellent work that's being done with regard to vehicle crime and role players like the South African Insurance Crime Bureau and so on. But with the big increase in hijacking of vehicles and truck hijacking and the sad cases that we've seen with the little children, I know it's not in this report, like Tegan Morris and so on, are there other interventions that the police is maybe looking or is looking into to in a way to address these crimes?
Hi, Commissioner, Mr. Minister. Carl Ganeski from the Business Day. Just to return to the issue of violence during community protests, just a little bit more detail, if you don't mind, on just how you, on numbers and perhaps resources in the public order policing going forward. And the second part of that question, there were two rather large operations this year, the elections and also the platinum sector strike, which saw quite a lot of energy and resources going into policing large areas and rapid deployment of resources. Any details on what this perhaps has taught you about how this unit's going to operate, perhaps within the police or with other units in the police and other departments going forward? Thanks.
Apologies, Program Director. Could I get, I think both the first question, I had the first question, but the second question I couldn't get it. Please, maybe starting with the first. If you don't mind.
Yes, two-part question. The first part, the resources and numbers within the public order policing unit going forward. Second part, large operations such as the elections, election violence hotspots, and also the platinum sector strike, crime intelligence, public order policing, various other departments, even private security working together. Just what has this kind of taught you about the issue of community violence, given how sporadic and quickly it can emerge and the effects it can have? Thanks.
Genevieve Quinzel from SARPA. This is a repeat question, actually, because I don't think it was answered, but murder went up by 800. What is the reason behind this? It was asked earlier.
Malungelo Boy from ENCA. Commissioner, one of the things you spoke about was that sexual crimes are down, whereas in the Eastern Cape, though, we're constantly seeing an increase of this. Why? Especially rape. And also the issue of police being involved in crime. Do you think that inspire confidence in people to go to the police stations and report themselves and report this matter? Thank you.
Good afternoon, Aldrin Simpia from Power News. Just on the question that Malungelo just asked now, Commissioner or the Police Ministry, are you guys at all looking at having a section of the stats that actually focuses on the number of police who are involved in crimes and looking at the ratio of police to the population? Would you say that we have enough police officers?
I'm Khalam Bata from Bloomberg. I just wanted to get a bit more clarification on the murder stats in terms of, can the commissioner please give us the murder, the amount of murders or number of murders per 100,000 people in the country, if she has that stat on her? Thanks.
Is there another itchy hand somewhere? No?
There is another itchy hand, if you'll take the question. Regarding the increase in drug-related crimes, is there at all a concern from the police about an increase in drugs coming into the country? I'm looking at the figures, the majority of the cases are in the Western Cape, where we've seen a lot of gang violence, and also in KZN and Gauteng. Notably, both KZN and the Western Cape have large ports. Gauteng has South Africa's biggest airport. So is there any concern about the actual entry of drugs into the country?
You know, drugs are a worldwide problem. And I can tell you that when we meet with the police chiefs in the region, we put our heads together to say, what are the roots of these drugs coming into our region, how can we work together to actually ensure that we jointly manage the various routes that are obvious in the region? We will always remain concerned about the number of drugs that come into the country. We are also concerned about, as I've said, we've closed something like 35 production platforms in the previous year. Indeed, with drugs, you start seeing a number of gangsterism emerging. We're doing a number of things. If you go into the Western Cape, Operation Combat to deal with gangsters, we've seen very, very good progress. A number of life sentences that have been notched in that province. And indeed, I think if you just look at some of the outcomes and the gains that come out of that operation, you can see that we're starting to make some inroads. In the Eastern Cape, we have made huge deployments to actually deal with gangsters in that place. And I think you would have heard last year that you were, there was a period where you were hearing of 2-3 people dying in a week. So we've had to intervene. So those additional deployments have actually started doing certain things in that place. So where we're seeing this in Free State also, there's also some rearing of gangsterism, and I know that the Free State has seriously focused on that area. So we're looking at all those things as they emerge, and you would always find a relationship between drugs and gangsterism. And it's turf wars. They fight for space to sell drugs. They fight for space to have dominance. So where you see more drugs, you would always find a lot of this gangsterism. So we're doing a number of things, really, to deal with those type of issues. And it's not just ourselves as a department. There's a whole drug master plan of the government. There's a whole government interdepartmental strategy for gangsterism. So we're also working together to see how else we work with the departments such as social development and others to deal with these difficult areas that are characterizing modern crimes that we're experiencing as a country. I'll try and ask them to bring us the ratio for murder quickly so that I can share it with you. In terms of number of police that, maybe let me say, even if I don't get it, go to your memory stick, you will be able to get the ratios for crime. I think it's about 3.5%, but you'll see how it migrated from 31.1% to 32.2%. So in that memory stick, you'll find it well computed. You can study it there. It shows you how these numbers play themselves into the ratio. The number of police, indeed, we focus very seriously on criminality, even within the police. Our business is to arrest those that commit crime, and it doesn't matter, even if there are hours we do. In the year under review, we arrested 762 police who were involved in crimes and various activities in that space. So we do arrest police. As we report, we've arrested 762 of these police, and as we do so, we go into discipline. The criminal case takes its course, but internally we run our own disciplinary processes, and we do discharge a lot of them. So that's an area of focus also for us. The issue of sexual crimes in the Eastern Cape. If I look at the Eastern Cape, and we're just trying to zoom, I think it's in areas such as Butterworth, and it's rural areas mostly where, you know, some of the contributors, the other areas are contributing, but we're also looking at that where, you know, as I've said, elderly women being targeted and those type of things. So we're looking at how else we can deal with those type of growth in the various forms of rape. We're very concerned, and we do believe that some of it is drug related, because you wonder where a phenomenon like this obvious, where young people are going to rape old people. It doesn't really make sense to anyone. So the use of drugs, these wongas and nyaupes also are contributing towards some of these processes. But we can engage further to give further analysis as we look into some of this. We will be having that type of engagement with each of the provinces to try and dissect precisely what contributes to that, and look at which areas, what type of interventions we should have, because if we don't, we'll be back here again telling you the same number. We would like to see changes and progress taking place where we have identified problems. The issue of confidence in reporting, I would like to believe that we're starting to see a lot of confidence. If I say to you that just on the issue of sexual offences against women and children, last year, as we were saying, we managed to achieve more than 600 life sentences, it tells you a story. To say people come forward, they walk the journey of the courts, and were able to convict people and take them away. And you take, for instance, a few of the cases that you see with children, we do arrest and we do convict. There are very few of these cases where we are having no arrests, no convictions, where children are involved. So there's a lot of work that is going into this work, and modernized processes such as you know, the offerings that come from our forensic science laboratories, and they are also helping us a lot through those processes to start showing us trend lines to say, in this area there seems to be somebody who is a serial killer, because we are picking up XYZ, and we are also using that information to assist us to investigate and to arrest. So I think I'm very optimistic about the progress we are making as a country, and challenges are there, but I think we have all the fundamentals that can help us to even become better as we tackle some of the challenges that are facing us. The 800 murders, why? Remember, as I've said, by the time the police come, the murder has happened. And it is in environments where one can say it's intimate, in a house, a husband kills a wife, a son kills a mother. So those type of issues, it's a very difficult area to police. And this is why I said earlier on when I started to say it requires each and every one of us to work together. To make sure, you know, I was listening to a report that I think it was on one of the televisions, where they were talking about a woman who was staying with a son who's about 40 years old. She's a nurse, she's a professional. She's been abused by this son for many years, and she's never reported it. And this son ultimately stabs her 40 times. It tells a story. To say, had she reported, and the neighbors are saying, we used to hear her screaming, but we thought it is a son and a mother. So it's those type of issues. By the time we come, this woman is dead. But if this woman understands that the police are there to help, and they can reach out to the station, and we can intervene much earlier, to ensure that she's protected together with the courts. The courts can do certain things to protect. So we really need help in this area. We showed a slide somewhere else where we were showing a very serious concentration of shebeens in one of the cities. And you can see that, as the minister is saying, you have more shebeens than you have schools. You have shebeens that are in front of schools. Those type of issues are not policing matters, but we can work together as a nation to ensure that bylaws are enforced, those shebeens operate during the times that they're supposed to operate, and they don't operate 24/7, and every other person is inconvenienced when you wake up in the morning, the car that you parked in front of the house is broken into, because we don't enforce certain things. So we have to work together, all of us, with the Metro Police, with society, so that we can deal with some of these crimes that are a product of the social conditions that we find ourselves in. We need lighting in the streets so that the opportunistic killer doesn't brutalize a woman who's walking in darkness to a station. If we have high mast lights, people can walk. Those that leave early for work are not afraid to be mugged and killed before they get there. So we need to work together. Policing is not the panacea of everything. Policing is there to work with all other efforts to ensure that we can tame some of the social ills that we find ourselves in. I think we've done. Yes.
The last word, Minister.
Thank you very much. Firstly, thanks very much for the questions and the contributions made, and I think they will also essentially assist us in refining and shaping our way forward from this point on as the South African Police Service. Now, there are issues that I would just need to comment on. The National Commissioner has given statistics about the question of police criminality, what has happened in that front and so forth, but I think that question was also backed up by two members of the South African citizenry have confidence in the South African police. Now, the statistics themselves that we're presenting represent 84%. So that in itself essentially is an indicator of this level of interaction between members of the community and ourselves as the South African Police Service. However, having said so, ourselves as the police service, we still have got a lot of work to do in improving relations between ourselves and members of this of the South African citizenry, including issues of image and all other negatives about ourselves. So much as South Africans have confidence in the South African Police Service, but ourselves also there's this work that we actually do need to undertake. I think there is what I would call a forever kind of question that has always arisen. Do we have enough policemen and women? But I think the question would be, how do you measure enough, for an example? Except that all we are saying through the statistics as we have presented them, that we are within the international sort of norms and the ratio distribution of 1:346 and so on. Now, however, the key question, perhaps this also taps into some of the points that the National Commissioner has spoken to, is that the issue of policing in our society is everybody's responsibility. And therefore, we need to activate ourselves at various levels of our communities, for an example, to deal with these particular matters. Communities such as communities that you find in Alexandra, for an example, they have established a community policing forum there, but out of which they also do patrols together, working with us as the South African Police Service and so forth. And I think there's quite a lot more that we can learn from communities such as those. The question of whether or not are we concerned about drug-related crimes, Indeed, we are. Indeed, we are, and of course, we'll continue to make the interventions as we have done in the past in terms of dealing with the infiltration of the drug trade into South Africa. But I think it is a question that is just simply broader than just drugs. In fact, it's the prevalence of drugs in our society is meant to disable the development of this society, essentially because it targets young people in by and large and so on. So it is something that all of us have got to take it up upon ourselves to look at how do we put together combined efforts to fight against drugs and drug-related crimes. The question at the back was about the issue of violence during protest action. You remember that we also said in the beginning that we will want to have a dialogue with South Africans on such questions. That question, including many others. Why is it that when you're pursuing what is legitimately is your right, either to services or any other right and so forth, but why is it that you think that you can achieve that right by beating up somebody else? You know, by burning a library or by damaging any other form of property, for an example. Why is it that we tend to think that you can validate your demand by destruction? So in a sense, those are some of the matters that require our society to have a thoroughgoing kind of interaction and engagement. The statistics have shown that over the 5-year period, what is the rate insofar as the issue of social and or public unrest related incidences that we've had to manage, but they've also shown some numbers that are not so much in terms of the issue of some of them having turned violent. And I think related to this very same question, there's a question of our capacity in terms of the public order policing. We stand at about 5,000 thus far, insofar as the public order policing unit. And of course, in the next 3-4 years, we are looking at doubling up that number. But besides the question of the warm bodies and the numbers that we want to to pull into the public order policing unit, for an example, there's also the issue of capacitating the public order unit in terms of equipment and other skills, of course, related to the issue of public order, policing and public order management. So thank you very much, Program Director.
I will give now the National Commissioner to close, but before I do, I've been told that for the media, the eating part will be where if you turn left, is that left? Oh, you go out and turn right, and you'll on your left. National Commissioner, ma'am.
Maybe just to say, as we close, remember, as we report to you, in this period, we have arrested 1.7 million criminals as the police. 5,106 were arrested by the Hawks, but the police overall has arrested 1.7 million criminals in the efforts that we've been trying to explain in percentages and all. And let me also say to you, we have confiscated almost 1.8 billion liters of alcohol in the year that we were reporting. And I'm mentioning that because alcohol plays a very critical role in the crimes that are being reported on right now. What shall be happening after about a week, each of the provinces will be making their own provincial announcements, which means this report will be dismembered to actually talk to the provinces as well as their nuances. So we just want to say that will be the next step. Don't be surprised when you hear a press conference in Mpumalanga talking different percentages. It will be percentages of that province so that the citizens in that particular province can understand what these statistics mean for their respective environments. Let me thank you, Chairperson. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The MECs, the provincial commissioners, could they also go across from this door to have their snacks and refreshments and other important people?